given that we talked a whole long time about mitosis and meiosis in chapter 8, and then we started to see that a few of those terms that we heard in chapter 8 were actually used in the first two parts of chapter 9, it stands to reason that chromosomes really are important to this whole business of Mendelian genetics. Now, as I told you before, Mendel didn't know anything about chromosomes. He didn't know that chromosomes were of any importance to where the information for his peas sat. He didn't know what chromosomes were. There wasn't anything like the science of genetics. And so what he did is work out these principles, not knowing what were the underlying mechanisms. And so he's working partly in the dark. This is always a challenge. It's always good when you're working in science that you have a complete background. But sometimes, when it comes to science, you have to step out and create some hypotheses, even though you don't know exactly what's going on. And so chromosome evidence, it turns out, provided an independent line of evidence to support Mendel's hypotheses. He didn't know about them. And so therefore, when somebody later tried to put together chromosomes and Mendelian genetics, then they became a proof for how Mendelian genetics operated. And all of this came down ultimately to the chromosome theory of inheritance, which states that, first of all, genes are located on chromosomes. Now, Mendel knew about pieces of information, and this is kind of like what he said in one of his hypotheses. So this is okay. This is certainly something that jives with Mendel's ideas. But then the behavior of chromosomes during meiosis, that is something he had no idea about. And not only the behavior of chromosomes during meiosis, but also then what happens when fertilization occurs. Those were key concepts he was missing in trying to come up with an explanation for these patterns he observed. But of course, people eventually figured this out. People eventually came to the realization how these tie together, and that's what we're going to do in this diagram here. Now, this is a relatively intense diagram, but to break it down for you, what it does is take some information from chapter 8. This is the information from chapter 8 where we showed how meiosis allows us to create genetic variation by independent assortment, so allowing each of the chromosomes to go their separate ways. That's what the underlying diagram with the chromosomes is. And if you flip back, you can see that. On top of that diagram, we have overlaid Mendel's experiment with the dihybrid cross, where he looked both at round and wrinkled, so the shape of the peas, and yellow versus green, which was the color. Now, when we did this last class, we were looking for whether there was dependent versus independent assortment. And so now we're putting two things together. We're putting together Mendel's principles with the principles of meiosis. So let's work through this for a minute. As you see at the top, there is a parental generation. And this parental generation consists of pure breeding round yellow plants. So they have big R and big Y. And it has the wrinkled green peas, which are little r, little y. So this is the standard setup with the peas. Now what we've done here is we have taken this information and mapped it onto two different chromosomes. And I want to be perfectly clear how this works. So you have on the part of this parent here, you have a chromosome pair, and on this chromosome pair, and I'm drawing this in an arbitrary position, you have the information for shape. And this parent, it's big R and big R. And on a second chromosome, and this is the smaller chromosome, even though it's a little bit hard to tell, you have the big Y and big Y. So that's what you have. 1, 2, 3, 4 chromosomes, 1, 2, 3, 4. And you have the the Y information, the color information on one chromosome, and the shape information on the other. Okay, so here's the shape information. And on the other chromosome is the color information. And of course, then the same type of chromosome exists on the other side. And in this case, all have small letters. So here's what you do, is you produce gametes in order to get to fertilization. Of course, the only gametes you can produce from this individual is the ones that carry the capital letters. And the only one from this individual is the ones that carry the small letters. What does fertilization do? It produces offspring, the first generation. And here you have all round yellow seeds. Why? Because we have the big R here that makes them round, and the big Y here that makes them yellow. Now, this should be pretty much clear to everybody. The key thing now is what happens in this first generation. The parental generation is pretty straightforward. Now, in order to follow the chromosomes and what Mendel does, we're going to take two separate tracks. The first one, we're going to look at the law or the principle of segregation. And if you look at the principle of segregation, we can actually follow either one of these branches, but we're going to just do the left one. And so what you see is that the big letter and the little letter, they don't stay together. And this is all it says. It says that the chromosome pairs get pulled apart. So one of them goes there and the other one goes there. And this is exactly what I drew for you in the lecture on meiosis. The big R and the little R don't stay together. Only one piece of information moves. That's one of Mendel's hypotheses, and now we know why. It's because of what happens in meiosis one. So the reason for why the law of segregation works is meiosis one. It's the separation of chromosome pairs. That's why the law of segregation works. Now, as the outcome, you then have gametes, in this case, just like mom or dad. Now, that's what we ended up with before. But, of course, that is not all we end up in this situation. So, how do we get to the other one? Well, that is where the law, the principle of independent assortment applies. Now we can figure out what happens to both of the long and the short chromosomes and how they get moved around. And remember, we talked about the idea that sometimes we shuffle things and sometimes we blend things. Well, this is all about the shuffling, how things get shuffled. And here we see that there was some shuffling. We actually have blue on one side, red on the other, and here it's vice versa. Well, that is independent assortment. So in this case, we see that in the case of these chromosomes, the red ones don't have to stay together. Here we have an example of a blue one and a red one together. So that is independent assortment. You can arrange them this way or the other way. Both of those work. Both of those are equally likely. And it just depends on which one happens to be on which side. If that happens, then you're going to get the other two gametes. And the idea is just to remember that when you have a genotype like this, and you try and figure out how many different gametes you can produce, use these arrows. There's one type of gamete. There's another type of gamete. Here's a third. And here's a fourth. So that way, you never forget how many different ways you can produce gametes. So all these different gametes, here's all the capital letters together, here's all the little letters together, and here's the two other versions. They all work out, and they're all equally likely, and that is what independent assortment is. And so this is the neat thing about how the chromosome behavior in meiosis fits together with Mendelian genetics. because the reason why, the exact reason why Mendelian genetics works the way he described it, is because the chromosomes do this thing in meiosis. And that's the key thing. It's really neat. If you consider this, you come up with these ideas and you think, okay, this is how it must be, but I don't really know how. And then somebody at some point says, oh, this is how. It's just really neat when two good things come together like that. Now, there were problems with this, and people still came up with some new things that they didn't quite understand. And again, once again, just as we had with these various things, things like incomplete dominance and so on, people were wondering, well, does Mendelian genetics really work? I mean, what is the problem here? Now, at that point, people had started to use different model organisms than pea plants, things that were a little bit easier to grow and that produced offspring a little bit quicker, and they used fruit flies. Fruit flies are still a favorite when it comes to studying genetics. And they uncovered something they called gene linkage. Gene linkage means that whatever produces the traits that you observe, they're actually on the same chromosome. Now, this is something that we didn't have in the last time. What we didn't have in the last time was to actually have the same characteristics that we're looking at on the same chromosome. We had different chromosomes the last time, but now what we have is the same. And so here is the idea behind this. You have a chromosome, and on this chromosome somewhere you have both the information for the body color and the information for the length of the wings on the same chromosome. That's different than what we had before. Because if you think about what we just did, we had the yellow information on one chromosome and the round information on another chromosome. But now we don't have that. And so people understood, okay, well, if these are on the same chromosome, then there are certain things that don't work. So let's test this out. This is the key thing, is that if Mendelian genetics works, then we're expecting a certain outcome from this experiment. This is called a test cross. And in a test cross, what you do is you take an F1. So in this case, this would be the F1, which is the heterozygous one. And instead of crossing it with another F1, you're crossing it with the homozygous recessive. That's why this is called a test cross and not just a normal cross. Normally, we do F1 and F1. This one is F1 with the homozygous recessive. So if you're homozygous recessive, you have black body and short wings. That's the non-wild type condition. If you are a heterozygous individual, you have gray body and long wings, which is basically the normal kind of fruit fly. And so if you're then doing this kind of experiment, you are creating these different phenotypes, and this is what you, on the left, this is what you would expect, these ones here. Now let me explain to you why. If you are one of those intermediate ones, if you're one of those F1 individuals, then you can get either this kind of gamete or that kind of gamete. So the possible gametes are this or that. And that is because these genes are linked. They're together on the same chromosome. That means they cannot assort independently. They cannot, because they're on the same chromosome. So therefore, if you have this as the gametes from the one individual, and this as the gametes from the other individual, because that's all you can get out of this one, then what you expect to get is some more like the dad and some more like the mom. That's what you'd expect. Well, there they are. some more like the mom, some more like the dad. But that is all you expect. You're expecting, based on this, 100% of them should be like this. But it's not true. Only 83%. So, if you look at this, and you know Mendelian genetics, you would say, wait a minute, close, but no cigar. Close because, yeah, sure, they are the most frequent by far in this population. But where do these come from? How do you get this mixture? These are on the same chromosome. The only way you can do it is if somehow information from the one chromosome could be transferred to the other chromosome. But how can that happen? Well, we know how this can happen. You've probably forgotten, but it happens because of recombination. It happens because of crossing over. That's what makes this work, and that's why it can be relatively unpredictable. That's why it's 83% instead of, you know, a nicer number like 75. And so here is the example. These are the homologous chromosomes, and on them, in this case, they have A and B, but they could have G and L, like we saw in the previous slide. And so they overlap. This is the crossing over part. And after they overlap, you end up with parental gametes. The parental gametes come from the outer ones. This one here, that's a parental gamete. And this one here, that's a parental gamete. The ones in the middle, the ones that have done this mixing, those are the recombinant gametes. Remember when I said this is when your genes become uniquely yours? That's what that is. And so these recombinant gametes at this fairly unpredictable frequency, that is what makes this happen. Now here's the solution to what Thomas Hunt Morgan finally found. He said, okay, this is the female I have, this is the male I have. The male is easy. It doesn't matter whether there's any crossing over or not, the male is always going to be little g and little l, no matter what happens. But with the female, this is where I can have a little bit of this interchange. First of all, clearly the female is going to produce what I expect, but allowing for crossing over, in fact, allowing for crossing over 17% of the time, because that's what he found, right? 17% of the offspring were different. That is where the key to this is. And so these recombinant gametes, if they then become the ones that get fertilized, then lo and behold, I have good reason for why this recombinant type exists. So it's not supposed to, but it does because of crossing over. And so in this case, Mendelian genetics really got us stuck. Mendelian genetics would not allow us to work this out. But understanding that crossing over is part of meiosis now rescues Mendelian genetics from being falsified. If you don't know crossing over, you say, well, I guess Mendelian genetics really doesn't work here. But it does. And it works because this crossing over can now account for some of this added variation. So it's pretty neat to see that Mendelian genetics keeps weaving its way back, because once people understood what happened here, they realized, oh, I guess Mendelian genetics is true after all.